Welcome back, everybody. We have another session today on the Jesuitical Science, session 49 of the Science is the New Religion script. And I'm gathered here with Michael. And I think this is going to be a different day that I'm in than him, because I think it's past midnight in Germany. But here it is still Sabbath, September 25th, but I think it must be the 26th of September 2021 in Germany right now. Michael, welcome.
Hello, Brett. Welcome, dear listeners. Not yet 25 minutes still to go.
Ah, okay.
So it's 11:35. Yes. I'm so sorry, but I'm doing my best to keep up with the script so that we soon get into the more recent topics. But I think that to explain everything and to explain also the influence and the importance of the Jesuits, last time we have spoken about the Ratio Studiorum and about the fourth vow and about all of the things about considering the Jesuits from their label or their paper bull, Regimini Militantis Ecclesia 1540. So we went into the fourth vow, we went into Jesuitical spiritual exercises, and we went into the Ratio Studiorum 1599. And therefore I thought that before we go into this science, we have to think about the science of the Jesuits. So if you think about last session where we set the hypothesis, what would you expect, what kind of education the people get in Jesuitical studios and studies and schools and universities? What do you think of Jesuitical science? So-called. And I came up with an idea during a session we did today with Daryl. Look what I found. You see that Jesuitical means belonging to Jesuits. Huh? I think that's common here. So the Jesuits are using their science, promoting their science in their education system by their Ratio Studiorum. But what means Jesuitical? So the kind of Jesuit science. Look at this. What does Etymology Online tell you? Jesuit means a member of the Societas Jesu, founded in 1533 by Ignatius Loyola to combat army, soldiers, Protestantism. Their enemies in both Catholic and Protestant lands accuse them of belief that ends justifies means. Hence the sense, quote unquote, a crafty or dissembling person, 1630, and Jesuitical meaning, quote, deceitful, designing, insinuating, unquote, 1610. So that means that the term Jesuitical has a negative meaning, deceitful, to deceive people. 1610. And that's about the time that we have approached with John Dee and with the other people soon coming up in that line of a timetable. Isn't that something? Deceitful. Jesuitical has the common meaning, deceitful. Yeah, never thought about that, but I'm glad that I have looked it up, Brett. Now I'm going into this study here. Reference work, Brilliant Online Jesuit Historical Graphic Online Jesuit Science before 1773. A historiographic essay. Yeah, that you can look it up on the internet. I will show you that it is a functioning document. Just copying in my browser. Yeah. So it's a little bit hard to find. Modified February 2017, The Jesuits in the Historiography of Early Modern Science. Okay. So I'm taking it over to the script now because it's more easy to read. Jesuit missions in Asia and Americas. Less than a decade after the establishment of the Society of Jesus in 1540, Jesuit missionaries were already traveling to Asia and the Americas. So very, very soon, almost immediately, they started to spread their doctrine around the world. How come? If they had just existed a little bit more than 10 years. So they were on a mission. These missionaries, means Jesuits, brought with them their education. We know the Ratio Studiorum officially has been dated to 1599. So how come, Brett, that even 60 years before they had some kind of a doctrine? From who or by whom?
Oh, ho. That's a very good question, Michael. I think I might know, but please go ahead, Michael.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's there are so many footnotes also here, Jesuit missions. They also brought along scientific instruments, including telescopes, and among their activities as they traveled, they made new measurements of both the Earth and the sky, adding important corrections to map of both. That reminds me of the Bible. On that sentence. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. What does the Jesuitical science teach us? The outcome is there was a big bam, everything was coming from evolution. We have a heliocentric system, etc., etc. So it's every time against the Bible. Mm-hmm. Because the Protestants were the people who were saying sola scriptura, only the scriptures. And because that, you see that once again, to combat Protestantism. Protestantism. Yeah? Enemies. To combat. We are talking about military. Yeah? So, and now you see, they are into science. So that rings a bell, Brad, that they are using science to combat Protestants.
Sounds pretty logical to me.
Yeah, because you see that out of a sudden, bam, bam, boom, they went into Asia and America and everywhere else, that we will go into this now. And we see that they have tried to spread their doctrine by the use of science so big time. So let's continue. China. The influence of the Jesuit mission to China was so important for the development of Chinese mathematics and astronomy that Joseph Needham, in his groundbreaking work, Science and Civilization in China, devoted a section to 17th century Jesuit contributions. We're speaking about 1600. Huh? This is the book. There's a PDF available. Needham broke with the prevalent view at the time that advanced science was primarily a European phenomenon, but he maintained the Copernican bias regarding its development. As a result, while Needham acknowledged that the Jesuits brought to the Chinese Euclidean geometry, the use of geometry in charting the movements of celestial body, means stars and planets, and in surveying, superior methods of predicting eclipses, new methods of computing, and new scientific instruments, including the telescope, Needham blamed the Jesuits for effectively forcing Ptolemaic astronomy on the Chinese and retarding their acceptance of Copernican astronomy. Needham apparently did not realize that in the 17th century, Jesuits taught Trichonic, not Ptolemaic, astronomy, and as the Jesuits began to accept and teach heliocentric astronomy in the 18th century. And I made that here in gray color. Began to accept, you see, I think they did not begin to accept, but that was also a doctrine that they switched from one extreme to the other extreme. We need a little bit time to do so. You see, that's from generation to generation, a little bit more pushy in a certain direction, because if they would have changed that direction out of a sudden, so that people would say that, oh, these people are nuts. And so it's just in science that you say that, okay, the truth of today is the lie of tomorrow. Yeah? So that's tomorrow's lie, is the truth of today. And so they switched their opinion. It's like Kerry Mullis said, oh yeah, they changed the rules, changing the rules constantly.
Those guys have got an agenda, which is not what we would like them to have, being that we pay for them to take care of our health in some way. They've got a personal kind of agenda. They make up their own rules as they go. They change them when they want to.
So I'm doubting that Jesuits began to accept. It's just, for me, it's just a doctrine that you don't do it overnight, and you need generations, because that if somebody is old, he cannot remember, and the children are being educated, so-called, in the school system, and so they are out of reach of the parents today. They are so indoctrinated with all the Jesuitical science today. But let's move further on. And teach heliocentric astronomy, which means the sun is in the center, in the 18th century. Chinese liturgy, through the presentations by Jesuit Michael Benoit, too incoherent to take seriously. Okay, this is opinion, yeah. Early modern Chinese scholars could reject heliocentrism without the Jesuits compelling them. Mathematics was central to the success of the Jesuit missions in China. As Florence Xia cleverly put it, had Chinese auditors had been more interested in the niceties of French or Italian cuisine than in Aristotelian cosmology or Tychonic instrumentation, the present book might well be a history of Jesuit chefs in the Celestial Empire. Xia told the story of the early Jesuit mission to China and its success in not only establishing their presence and acceptance there, but also in presenting their story to Europeans. Her parameters were two books about that mission, De Christina Expeditione apud Sina Suspecta, Ab Societate Jesu by Matteo Ricci, a very high-ranking Jesuit, and Voyage means journey, de Siam des Pères Jesuites, which means the journey to Siam through the Jesuit fathers. By Guy Tachard, Xia showed how the Jesuits used mathematics to make inroads into scholarly Chinese society. They presented their way as, quote, a model for imitation, unquote, for other missionaries. So they found the acceptance in the school education system by mathematics in the first place. Okay. Xizang left the mathematics of the sky for the mathematics of the earth as she narrated the story of the effect of Western cartography introduced by the Jesuits on Chinese mapmaking. She described how Ricci, Matteo Ricci, introduced a more accurate European map to replace the late Ming map that had China in the center of a square earth surrounded by four seas. Interesting, huh? A square earth. So we have a new concept, right? It took the Chinese much longer to accept Ricci's map than it took to accept his astronomy and mathematics, but in eventual adoption allowed China to participate more fully in early modern trade and geopolitics. Quote, the Chinese vision of the physical dimension of the world was much enlarged as a result of intellectual exchange with the Jesuits and the Chinese engagement with the larger early modern world, especially with the maritime Europeans. So you accept their doctrine because that helps you to make money. Huh? Sort of. As can be gathered from both Xia and Sung's books, Matteo Ricci was crucial to the success of the China mission. He had studied mathematics and astronomy with Clavius at the Collegio Romano, at the Roman College, and was himself a gifted mathematician. He was not the first Jesuit in China when he arrived in 1582. It's 42 years after that the order has officially been granted by the papal bull, but he realized that success depended on acceptance of the Jesuits by the ruling class. And it is, so to speak, 17 years before official Ratio Studiorum. So that means that they had this doctrine beforehand, being handed over to the people who were on their mission to other countries, that they shall be convinced of the Jesuitical superiors in science, so that they accept that the Jesuits are becoming the scholars of their pupils, of their children. That's, in my humble opinion, that's the doctrine. Get them while they're young. To achieve that acceptance, he mastered Chinese and Confucian writings. He dressed and behaved like a Mandarin. Ah, where we know that from, Brad? From the fourth vow. He used mathematics and science to interest the Chinese. He introduced them to European instruments such as the chiming clock, which enchanted them. Ah, who's the enchanter in the Bible?
Oh, yeah. We know that.
Long time ago.
Not the good guy.
No. The Chinese imperial calendar depended on the prediction of eclipses, and Ricci showed them that European astronomy was better for that goal. He also taught Euclidean geometry to the Chinese elite and translated Euclid elements into Chinese. So there was one guy, Matteo Ricci, who was so wise in the worldly sense of way that he educated the elites in China, and they brought the doctrine of the Jesuits by the way. Yeah, but you see that it was useful for the Chinese guys to get into Europe, yeah, to have a trade, because then when you have the same calendar, you see it's easier for trade. And you see, it's for the love of money at the moment. Ricci was another colorful figure, and like Kircher, he attracted a non-scholar to write a popular biography. More important is the biography by Ronnie Pochisia, which went into depth regarding all aspects of Ricci's career in China. Teacher, author, translator, scholar, diplomat, priest, and missionary. Oh, so that means that there is no secular system, huh? It's church and state, once again. Yeah? It's the teacher, the scholar, the priest, and the missionary. But Ricci's success depended most on his abilities in science and mathematics, with his expertise in mathematics and astronomy, because you cannot do astronomy if you are not educated in mathematics. You cannot predict a movement or a distance or something else if you don't know how to proceed with mathematics. So the base thing is mathematics. His library of Western books and Western scientific instruments. Ricci, the master of the way, was worthy of the attention of Confucian literati. So, yeah. Ricci's successor. Now it gets really interesting, I hope. The continuing success of the mission was ensured by the Jesuit astronomers and mathematicians who followed Ricci and became directors of the Beijing, means Peking in German, Beijing, the capital city of China, imperial means from the emperor, observatory from 1644 to 1773. Ah, great. It's too dangerous information, so Microsoft has just put us down. It's the first time today. This is too valuable information. Chuck, there it is. Goodbye.
Jeez.
If it is nothing, they are responsible for the Chinese way of time. I have a quote here. In 1720, Michelangelo Tamburini, then general of the Jesuits, said to the Duke of Brancas, quote, "See, my lord, from this room I govern not only Paris, but China, not only China, but the whole world without anyone knowing how it is managed." Quote of Andrew Steinmetz, History of the Jesuits, Volume 1. I got this book already, but I haven't looked it up. But this is the quote. You see, 1720 would be the time, when the Jesuits were in control of the Beijing Imperial Observatory.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So that would absolutely fit, that quote.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? That would fit. So this is the Beijing Ancient Observatory. Cannot. Copy. We'll copy. We'll show you live. We'll show you live what it is about in English so that you don't have to take German classes. So this is a Beijing Ancient Observatory. Okay? And now we make some fun. We read the Wikipedia page. It is a pre-telescopic observatory located in Beijing, China. The observatory was built 1442 during the Ming Dynasty and expanded during the Qing. It received major reorganization and many new, more accurate instruments from Europeans, means Jesuits, in 1644. Okay? And now we make it real. Now we are looking for Jesuit in that context. And we find, five hits. Five? Let's look it up. That was the first one. Second one. The current observatory was completed in 1442. It assisted the Ming and Qing astronomers in their observation reports for the emperor, as he was considered the son of heaven. The movements of the heavenly bodies were an important affair. Another function was to assist sea navigation with Muslim scholars recruited for their expertise in the area. In the mid-17th century, after winning an astronomy contest, the Jesuit Ferdinand Verbiest was awarded complete charge of the astronomy's observatory by the Emperor of China. In 1673, he supervised the rebuilding of some of the instruments. He and other Jesuits helped to further develop the observations of the stars and the planets. That is the second hit. Next hit. List of Jesuit sites. Okay, I think we had it, yeah? But see that Ferdinand Verbiest also was a very prominent 70, was a Flemish Jesuit missionary in China. He was an accomplished mathematician and astronomer. You see, that is the combination of two that makes it. Huh? That was same with Matteo Ricci. And proved to the count of the Kangxi emperor that European astronomy was more accurate than Chinese astronomy. He then corrected the Chinese calendar, etc., etc. Being given the role of the head of the mathematical board and director of the observatory. He became close friends with the emperor, who frequently requested his teaching in geometry, philosophy, and music. Huh? Verbeest worked as a diplomat, cartographer, and translator. He spoke Latin, German, Dutch, Spanish, Hebrew, Italian, and Manchu. He wrote more than 30 books. In 1760s, Verbeest designed what some claim to be the first ever self-propelled vehicle. Many, or some, or who, claim this is the world's first automobile, in spite of its small size and the lack of evidence that it was actually built. Yeah, so he was an inventor too. Yeah. He was in Leuven, that is where the area where Jörg lives, to study philosophy and mathematics. He joined the Society of Jesus in 1641. He continued to study theology. He completed his studies in astronomy and theology in Rome. His intention had to become a missionary in a Spanish mission to Central America, but this was not to be. His call was to the Far East, where the Roman Catholic Church was on mission to compensate for the loss of Catholic believers to the emerging Protestantism in Europe. So that means that the Jesuits actually are Catholics, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's not the Society of Jesus then, Brett, or is it? If you sink in that sentence, if you let sink in that sentence, that means when the Roman Catholic Church out of a sudden was on a mission, it means mission means Jesuit. Yeah, so the Roman Catholic Church used the Jesuits to compensate for the loss of Catholic believers to the emerging Protestantism in Europe by using Jesuitical science. So he left for China from Lisbon, München, Portugal, accompanied by Father Martino Martini, 35 other missionaries, etc., etc.
Wasn't it enchantments, Michael?
Sorry?
Wasn't it the enchantments of something? I forget what it was there earlier in the text that got into the observatory.
Yeah, but that was on Matteo Ricci or on the other one here.
Sure, okay.
I think that was enchant.
Oh, it's in the script.
You guys look it up.
Yeah,
that was Matteo Ricci, yes. Mm-hmm. He introduced them to European instruments such as the chiming clock, which enchanted them. Yeah. That's it here. Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Blinded by science.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
It happens. So
from the 35 people sending abroad to China, only 10 survived. 1659. And then he was leading the mission until 1660 when he was called to exist. To the director of the Beijing Observatory and the head of the mathematical board in his work in astronomy. So you couldn't get into astronomy if you were not expert in mathematics. Yeah. So then the emperor changed and the government was not in favor of the Jesuits, who suffered increased persecution as a result. Mm-hmm. So then they won an astronomy contest, etc., etc., etc. Yeah. But the main thing is that this is the steam car designed by Verbeest in 1672, alleged from an 18th century print. So that is the first known automobile, if that is correct. You see, that is the Jesuits. Huh? We do not know anything. We cannot take anything for granted here. But just to point out how important these people are. Okay. So that was about the Beijing Observatory. The Americas.
In studies of Jesuit contribution in the New World, hello Brett, cartography and national history have attracted the most attention. As noted with China, mapmaking was very important in the Age of Discovery, and Jesuit missionaries to the Americas were involved here as well. David Busseret gave an overview of Jesuit involvement in cartography in Central and South America, including reproductions of 30 Jesuit maps. Ernest Burroughs focused on cartography in Mexico and on the work of the Jesuit Eusebio Francisco Kino. Kino is the German name for cinema. Cinema. Moving images, huh? And that's why I came up with the 2 Thessalonians verse 9.
Oh, yeah. With 6 through 12 you have listed. Should I read it? And now ye know that withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness and them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness.
Yeah, that came up into my mind. Sorry that you see that lying wonders and strong delusion. And then Revelation 13:11, when there was another beast, and the beast, you see that with the image. Yeah, so that Revelation 13:14, you see that the image of the beast. Yeah, by image, I have to rely on this moving images in cinema. Yeah, and people nowadays, they sit in front of their smartphones, tablets, TVs, monitors, yeah, and they believe everything which is coming out of this box.
Isn't that interesting that the CIA, of all people, actually work along with the different motion picture companies these days?
Mm.
So they're pretty good at propaganda, I think, Michael.
And they have so much worldly and financial power behind it, yeah? Yeah. But you see that the image to the beast actually is just an image. Yeah? You see, if you see something on television, it is not real.
It's just an image. That's
it's
right.
Just an image. Yeah. Also, deceased people can appear on television. Seems as if they were living, they are moving, they are speaking.
Sure. Yeah?
But it's just an image. It is just an image. And now look what
isn't
kind of
that
picture
interesting? It says should make an image to the beast, not of the beast, but to the beast.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and it also speaks in Revelation 13 that the 666 number is a number of a man.
Yes.
And this man is in relation to the beast.
Hmm.
This man is the beast.
Yeah.
So the beast and the man are, what would you say, working together?
Yeah, sure. It's an entire system. It's a beast system. Yeah, and they make an image to the beast.
Which he had a wound by a sword and did live. And there are different ways of looking at that, Michael. And I know that
Seventh-day
Adventists have been teaching that doctrine of the second beast being the United States of America. And the first beast being that of Rome, which in most circumstances works out to be true. But when you consider that the first beast is the Roman Empire and the second beast is the papacy, well, that changes things a little bit, Michael. And in James Aiken Wiley's book, The Seventh Vial, that's how it's described.
I never participated in these kind of prophecies. You see that I think it is on different levels to be seen.
Yeah, and so therefore I do not participate in any prophecies, and I'm not saying that the cinema is the image to the beast, but it is the image of the beast system. Yeah, so I don't say that it corresponds here to the cinema.
Well, what I'm saying, Michael, is if you make an image to the beast, wouldn't that be propaganda?
Yeah, for example, and also it would mean that the beast has got an image. Yeah, but you see that what is an image? An image is not a picture. Well, if you go
sharper
to
sharper image,
I think. Yeah, if you go to the origin of the word image, it means an artificial representation that looks like a person or thing.
Ooh.
Yeah, a likeness, a reflection, a statue. Yeah, but you see that how people see somebody or something.
An imitation.
An imitation, yes.
An imitate, like the imitation of Christ.
Yeah, look here. We are talking about Latin and Greece.
Yes.
At that time of the Book of the Revelation. A copy, imitation, likeness, statue, picture. So that they bow down to the picture presented.
Phantom,
to them.
A ghost, an apparition.
Yeah.
An idea, an appearance. Oh,
yes.
Baby.
Yeah, it's the image of that, for example, that the papacy wants to heal the world and feed everybody, and that everybody takes this. You know what
above
I say.
Above the law, yeah.
Yeah, you see, meaning the reflection in the mirror is early 14th century. You see, it's only an image. It is not real. Yeah, so if they present an image of the beast system, yeah, they represent it, for example, by the means of television. Yeah, you receive a vision and people take that for granted. They think this is real, but it's an illusion. It is as they want you to see it, but it is not as it is. It is like that putting out a forged Bible and say, this is the holy word of God. But it isn't. People are being blinded by the light. They've been blinded by the doctrine. And so what does cinema do? They sell illusions. Yeah.
Yes, they do. They sell illusions.
Yeah. What? Look at this. What is this other than some kind of a church with an altar on it, with an image presented to the people? Doesn't that remind you of a church? A gathering of people believing in something they see, but which is not real, but for the amount of time, for the 2 hours when the movie, so movie means moving pictures, when the moving images are approaching on the big screen, like on the Big Brother of 1984, people actually believe, oh, we're in the movie, and I hope that my hero makes it, and I hope he gets the girl.
Michael, let me tell you something. This reminds me of an experience I had in my lifetime where I went to a movie with this fella from my church, and I saw someone else from our church in the same theater. And the movie we saw was Top Gun. Do you remember Top Gun?
Yeah, Tom Cruise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Tom Cruise.
Everybody right. wanted to be a fighter pilot. Mm-hmm. Take My Breath Away was the
yeah,
very interesting
yeah.
song.
Blah, blah, yeah. blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, it's the name, please don't destroy the session. The name of the song, actually, the band name was Berlin. That's why I remember it. And I used it in the satanic media or satanic music agenda in German sometimes as an example. So that, do you really know what it means that if somebody is taking your breath away? It means that somebody kills you. Yeah,
that's pretty bad.
Yeah, you have it. You have to take it literally.
It's not very nice.
Yeah, you have to take it for granted. Yeah, you see, take my breath away means, kill me. I'm out of breath means, yeah, there's no life in it. It's not a compliment. People don't get it. They say, it's so beautiful. It takes my breath away. Yeah. It means you are sick or you get to die.
Talk about vain deceit.
God is putting the breath of in your nostrils, and man became a living soul.
Yep.
If somebody is robbing you out of, is making you out of breath, or is stealing your breath, or takes your breath away, then he takes your soul away. Isn't that so far-fetched? You see, that is Bible. Yeah, I think it is in the second chapter of Genesis. Yeah. Or is it in the first? I cannot. I think it is even in the first. Oh, and in the second. Okay. And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. Take my breath away. Yes. The breath of life. Take my life away. And That's I've true. Got no living soul.
That's right. It's not funny, actually.
It's not funny.
No. It isn't at all.
Nobody reads, almost nobody reads the Bible.
But Michael, you know how big that movie was?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody wanted to go see it at my age.
Oh, and he's on a mission too, Tom Cruise, because he is a very prominent member, if not the most prominent member, of Scientology. Ah, the founder of it has some ties to Aleister Crowley. Ah. Later, not now. We are in the 16th century. Yeah. Just saying that all these inventions are coming from Jesuits. Yeah? So this is the other part of the ceremony. Yeah, people sitting in red chairs, staring in front of the screen, looking at the image, having a good time. Yeah, popcorn all night long. Andres Prieto's important book on the Jesuit missions in the Spanish colonial empires in Americas underscored the context for the study of the natural world that helped the Jesuits adapt to conditions unique in this area. Both the practical and theological challenges presented by autochthonous cultures and the need to survive in what was often an aggressive and unfamiliar environment forced the missionaries to describe, explain, and utilize nature and the indigenous lore about it. And now something hefty is coming up soon. Jesuits in South America often left the cities to live among the inhabitants. Yeah, be a Jew among Jews, be a Protestant among Protestants, or be an Indian about Indians, and a Native American among Native Americans, etc. They had to learn the local languages, customs, and nature in order to survive. And now comes the big thing. And Prieto, interesting, pointed out the effect of their need to compete with local shamans to succeed in their missions. Quote, and now please listen very carefully. Since shamans drew their authority and prestige mainly from their ability as healers, the missionaries were forced to assume the role of medicine men in the missions if they were to displace them as spiritual leaders. Under these circumstances, the knowledge of the medical uses of the local flora was of paramount importance for the missionaries. The Jesuits were enjoined from studying medicine so that they would not compete with other orders, but they had the education to adapt to the needs of their localities. I don't know. Fauci, anybody? They were forced to assume the role of the medicine man in the missions to be a spiritual leader. So you see that now it is not only mathematics or astronomy, now it comes down to medicine. So now we have also three different branches where the Jesuits are superior: mathematics, astronomy, and medicine. The Jesuits were enjoined from studying in medicine. Okay, I'm ready. So, and like their confreres in other parts of the world, the Jesuits in South America had to fit their understanding of nature into an Aristotelian framework. Yeah, Greece once again. But Aristotle had claimed that life was impossible in a torrid zone. So how could a missionary in Peru, not far from the equator, deal with this? In the case of José de Acosta, he corrected Aristotle's mistake using Aristotelian precepts to soften his deviations from his master. Mm-hmm. José Sánchez Labrador of Paraguay and his associates continued the work of the understanding of the natural world. Conclusion. The tight network of the Society of Jesus has left a huge trove of letters and other unpublished manuscripts in addition to the published books, and let me add the unpublished works, that give the scholar important sources to examine, and increasingly they have been taking advantage of it. As a result, a lot of work had been done uncovering significant contributions of Jesuits to early modern science, and especially regarding the 16th and 17th centuries, an increasing large numbers of books and articles are being published. So we are in the 16th and 17th centuries. Currently, in our study, is science the new religion? Yeah? And I think that is a very, very interesting article. Yeah, and these are the notes for it. Yeah, from a history of a concept of a scientific revolution, a historiographical inquiry, the origin of modern science, Copernicus and the scientific revolution, Martin Luther quote, we will come to this also, Lynn Thorndike, a history of magic and experimental science, New York, Columbia Press, etc., etc., yeah? So these are quite a few books mentioned here. For a background on Jesuit education in Europe before the suppression of the order, see Paul Grandler's Jesuit School in Europe, a historiographical essay. So then we have the sun in the church cathedrals as solar observatories. Interesting, huh? Didn't you know that? That many churches also, they got a sun wheel, or they got in the center, they got an opening so that the light can get into the church. Oh, so many things are here. Peter Deere, In Discipline and Experience, A Mathematical Way in the Scientific Revolution, from 1995. Deere first proposed the idea that the Jesuits contributed significantly to the concept of experiment in his article, Jesuit Mathematical Science and the Reconstitution of Experience in the Early 17th Century. We are talking about of the 17th century. So we are talking about the time when John Dee was, having his time in Prague, left Prague, and then something happened in Prague, which we will go and study in the next session, I think. But you see that this article has been backed up with several sources, which all seems very, very interesting. Very interesting. For example, here, the Academy of Mathematics of the Collegium Romanum from that period when the Jesuit just started. Yeah, and the Jesuits, they had the total funding and backup of the Roman Catholic Church, as we just learned, Brad. Yeah, so that they were able to go to Asia to conquer back the lost terrain, or the lost people, which they had lost to Protestantism. And you see that the Italian country, they had the majority of the universities, the universities were all Catholic in Italy. The Reformation didn't start in Italy.
No. That's right.
So many interesting books that we have to go into. Nope,
the Reformation started in Germany.
Yeah, more or less also in England, yeah, but not in Italy. Yeah, not in Italy as far as I know. You see that there are so many books to go into, and therefore I'm very glad.
Yeah, you're right. It was in Great Britain, if you think of John Wycliffe.
Yeah, that was my first.
That's
first,
right, first that's book, right, yeah. That's right. And you know, actually Jan Hus was before him, wasn't he?
Yeah, sure. Prague also, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah. Oh, wait. No, maybe I'm wrong. No. It was Hus that carried Wycliffe's doctrine. That's what it was. That's right. So, yeah, actually, it was John Wycliffe was the always known as the morning star of the Reformation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So where to go to next? You see that... I could insert a video of Kerry Mullis celebrating the scientific experiment where he's talking about his experience in the science world. And he says there are other reasons why science is made. It's about many claims like the Earth is warming up and the ozone hole and all the other things. And he says there is so much things and you have to look for the details, and maybe I can fit it in here so that we don't have to read subtitles and guess what he's telling us. Yeah? But it's very interesting they said that science is not independent. Yeah, it's been always and it is and it will always be funded by people in power who got the money for the observatories, for the laboratories, for sure. The things. Yeah, so you're dependent on the money. You know, you depend on the Antichrist system.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he says here, you have to find out what these words are meaning. This is German. And when you listen to these guys who are talking about it big time and make a lot of money, yeah, you will be informed falsely and you worry about the wrong things. he doesn't mean the eternal life. Yeah, he's a.
That's right.
Nevertheless, interesting, huh? Mm-hmm. So coming down to index librorum prohibitorum, a claim which everybody is familiar with. You guess who has presented that to the world, huh?
The Antichrist,
which is in control of everything which has to do with materialism. The Index Librorum Prohibitorum, the list of prohibited books, was a list of publications deemed heretical or contrary to moral by the sacred congregation of the Index. So this is censorship. This is real censorship. Yeah. Now this is not putting down a video on something. That this is just condemning. Yeah. Yeah. We were talking about 1564. We're talking about the life of. When John Dee, once again, on these alchemists and everywhere. You see, we're talking about that specific time. We are in the 16th century right now, 16th to 17th century. So Catholics were forbidden to read them without permission. Interesting, huh? So you not ought to know some heretical claims. Yeah, it's like in the modern times, everything comes back again, Brett. Yeah, so it's this list of prohibited books is fake news, something like that. Okay, so there was a Decretum Glacianum, a Pauline index, then there was a Tridentine index, etc., etc. But finally, they had the index of prohibited books, which banned thousands of book titles and blacklisted publications, including the work of Europe's intellectual elites. Yeah, so the papacy says, whom do you serve, what do you believe, and who do you follow? It's not anyone who has made an invention or so. It's the papacy, it's the Pope who says, no, I don't allow that this book will be published or read. And you think that book burning was some artifact of the Third Reich of the 20th century? No, absolutely not.
Older than that, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, such books included the work by astronomers such as Johannes Kepler, we will soon come to him, which was on the index for 200 years. Or by philosophers such as Immanuel Kant, critic of pure reason, etc., etc., etc. Or translations at the Bibles that have not been approved. Think of one, Brett.
Yeah, well, our favorite, yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
1611 King James.
Yes. Yeah.
Authorized version of the Bible.
Yeah. So it's a canon law of the Latin Church once again. I'm very glad they say Latin Church so that nobody is mixed up here, that everybody knows that it's the Latin Church, the dead language church.
Very good.
Yeah. Some of scientific theories contained in works in early editions of the index have long been taught at Catholic universities.
Oh, by the way, Michael, that just quick rings a bell as to our last session when we were talking about the Georgia Guidestones and you were talking about a new living language. Mm-hmm. I would be surprised if it was Latin. They're gonna raise the dead.
Maybe it's some digital language. You see that I think that more likely this will come into effect once again. You see that maybe you have been prohibited to read books because books are bad for CO2.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. So everything will be digital. So either you have a one, which is allowed, or you have a zero and it is prohibited.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that you can destroy every knowledge in the world by simply making it digital and then to erase it. Yeah, simply erase it on the computers and then it's gone. It's out of the internet. It's bam. And even if you find it, you're not allowed to read it.
And there's no written record anymore because they're all, shut down because, you get COVID-19 if you go in the library and read a book.
Yeah, something like this. You see that everything, I think, will be digitally. And if you then think of a living language in a digital world, yeah, maybe there's some artificial robot there. Hi, this is Google.
Yeah, this is New Babylonia.
Yeah, New Babylonia. Yeah, I'm Babylonia, and I will guide you to everything you ought to know.
I'm Babylonia.
Yes. Yeah, people are actually so focused on their smartphones today. They cannot live without them. Yeah. When I was today taking out for a walk, yeah, three youngsters approached me on the other side of the sidewalk. Yeah. Oh, staring at the smartphone. Yeah. Watch your step. No, my smartphone has a camera and he's absolutely detecting the pavement in front of me so that I cannot be hurt. Really, you cannot imagine how spoiled our youth is. It may sound funny, but maybe our youth is youthless. I don't know. I really don't know. I have a hard time imagining that our youth will read the King James Bible 1611. I have really a hard time with that. But you'll see, we'll never give up hope. Yeah. For example, the general prohibition of books advocating heliocentrism was removed from the index in 1758. But two Franciscan mathematics had published an edition of Isaac Newton's Principia Mathematica in 1742, which commentaries and preface stating that the work assumed heliocentrism and could not be explained without it. Sure, because if you once have a doctrine, then everything else has to follow that doctrine. So this is just to understand that the Pope forbids all his followers to read certain books. Yeah? Sacred Congregation of the Index. Yeah? 350 years almost. My. Can you imagine? Yeah. So this is a printing press from 1811 in Munich, Germany. Yeah. You see that 1450, so a long time ago, the book press started. And so people could read. And even when some things were ready to have been translated, like Luther did in German, the Bible, then they could read the Bible on their own. The first time. You see how big impact that must be. It's a wow. It's unbelievable. Yeah. Yeah. And so later on, you got copyright laws and all the claims, and they will try to do everything to get rid of the of books and knowledge which is not useful for the Catholic followers or Catholic leaders. Yeah. So this is the title page of the first papal index. 1557. So it's quite near the time when the Jesuits approached with their science. Huh? Interesting.
And this is the list of forbidden books.
Yeah.
Wow.
The first papal index. Yeah. Yeah, you see, it's not anything new.
No.
The restriction of knowledge has been,
put out,
expanded. 1559 is almost
five hundred
years ago. Yeah.
Think about all of the forbidden YouTube videos now.
Yeah, yeah. It's a list of publication deemed heretical or contrary to morality by the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. Yeah, it's the same. It sounds a little bit strange in Latin, yes. Yeah. So that just was to give you an example that you cannot be sure that anything you will approach on Wikipedia or so is absolutely unlimited knowledge. No, it is restricted. It was restricted for 350 years or almost. And also today, so many things are being deleted. Yeah, so many things.
Well, especially, we could give an example in history of the listing in the Catholic Encyclopedia of, let's see now, what was it? The coronation oath, trying to remember now, and I have a tough time remembering.
Yeah, but you see that they have an official instrument in preaching what is correct and what is not. And so that in the Roman Catholic belief system, you see that they have to be saved by works, that they have to follow the Pope in order to be saved. Yeah. So when Galileo was being condemned in 1633, you see officially they have condemned him. But you see that the Roman Catholic Church is not only a church, but also a political system. And so we will soon go into this with Galileo. And so you see that these restrictions, they took place in Germany also during the Third Reich. What a coincidence, huh?
Michael, it's the Royal Declaration. When you look that up in the 1913 edition of the Catholic Encyclopedia, you'll find that they talked about the... what is it now? The coronation oath in Great Britain. They actually condemned the doctrine of transubstantiation in the coronation oath of Great Britain. And now you find when you go online and you do a search or any modern version of the Catholic Encyclopedia, that's been omitted. They no longer admit that there was a doctrine of transubstantiation, basically a rebuke.
Yeah. What year? What year? 19?
Sorry?
What year was it? 19?
1913, Catholic Encyclopedia. You can find that on my archive.org account. I have the 13th edition or the 1913 edition, I forget how many volumes of it, but you'll find it under our Royal Declaration. If you look up Royal Declaration in that edition, I forget which volume. I think it might be the 13th volume, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, I think that that's a little bit too hard to look for it online at the moment.
Well, I'll tell you, that's a prime example in history before the internet of the suppression of a Catholic explanation of an event such as, you know, the Royal Declaration. They had just conquered the Royal Declaration in 1913, and they were proud of it, obviously, and they wanted to publish that to the world. See what we did? We actually convinced these Protestants that they're wrong, and now we got them under control, and they no longer protest transubstantiation. You see? Here's our proof. You know, that's what they did. And now that's been wiped away. They have World War I, of course, and then World War II, which was far worse and just completely wiped out our history and our knowledge. So we can't concentrate on these things anymore. But, you know, Protestant Great Britain was very strong for a long time, couple hundred years. Mm-hmm. And they were hit pretty hard with Jesuits, weren't they? And so are we in the United States now.
Yeah, without free speech, no search for truth is possible.
Yeah. Yep, that's right.
Yeah, this is not 100 years ago. This is 88 years ago. No?
Yeah, that's right.
88 years.
Not that long ago.
Not that long ago, no. Okay. Oh, not John Milton, please.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's move on. Yeah, you see that it is nothing new, and it has been in certain ages. So all this censorship and restriction of things which were unfavorable for the Roman Catholic Church. Yeah. So that if you go into this, you see that there's repetition all over again. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So also French guy René Descartes went on the index, and many scientists went on the index, so that they officially could be claimed as heretics. Yeah. So. Okay, so then let's move along to the next subject. Oh, no, don't. Oh, sorry. Yes. This is today. This is climate change. When Arnold Schwarzenegger congratulated the Pope that he finally sees the problem and the importance of climate change. Yeah. So the pupil thanks his teacher. Yeah, you see that antenna? Ah, okay. So, and Mr. Schwarzenegger also during his rulership as a governator of California, that the Bible became hate speech in California because that it could not be taught about homosexual criticism in public schools in California. But I think that is also repetition here. So then let's go into this year. You will see that nobody would know what a uni Wuppertal is in America. This is the University of Wuppertal. Wuppertal is a bigger city in Germany, I think about 100,000 inhabitants. And this is a dissertation, the Jesuit Science Network, a digital prosopographic on Jesuit scholars in the early modern science. It's an inaugural dissertation to get a doctor degree of philosophy in the faculty of science and culture of the University of Wuppertal. I don't know what Geistes- and Kulturwissenschaften now is the equivalent in English is. I don't know. It's the mental and culture sciences of the University of Wuppertal, of Dagmar Mrozek, of Poland. Okay? So, have fun with that. Yeah. Once again, the title, yeah? The Jesuit Science Network. Huh? Could be fitting in our session here, I think. Table of contents. This is 245 pages, yeah? We do not do 20 sessions on that. So, Jesuitical science. From the Constitutionis Societat Jesu 1558 to the Ratio Studiorum 1599. Aha, so that would be our time area here. Then the Jesuit bibliographical tradition, the Bibliothèque de la Compagnie de Jésus. Then outlining the content of Jesuitical science in the early modern period, Cursus Mathematicus. Then from research interest to research task, data sources, etc., etc., etc. Technical adaptations, reaching the audience, showcasing the Jesuit Science Network 1, the website and screenshots. So I think that if you really want to go into that, I have to post a link in the description box of the video. Then you have enough stuff for days. Yeah? But you see, this is an official publication in Germany, in English. Jesuitical Mathematics in a Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Yeah, because the female author is Polish, of course. Yeah, see how many ties it is, more than 200 pages to receive a doctor's degree. Yeah, isn't that interesting? So this is openly available at the moment. Yeah. The Jesuit Science Network. Aha. So let's go into this. 1558 to 1599, page 33. Jesuit Science. Mm-hmm. 33. I'm anxious to read that. As I've mentioned earlier, Jesuit Science does not just make up two-thirds of the Jesuit Science Network title, but this is actually a concept with a particular meaning. Used as a fixed expression in the research literature, it is often featured in the titles or subtitles of articles, collections, or monographs. Expressions such as Jesuit Mathematics or Jesuit Natural Philosophy, where science is replaced by a specific subject, are also frequent occurrences, raising the question whether they can be simply viewed as subsets of Jesuit science or constitute concepts that fundamentally differ in their meaning. Taking a closer look at the contents of these works reveal that Jesuitical science comes with a set of predetermined qualities, but that these qualities are rarely explicitly mentioned. At most, authors allude to them in some way.
Alfredo Dini's contribution in one of the collections on Jesuit science, edited by Mordecai Feingold, seems especially notable to me in this regard. The paper, whose title does not refer to Jesuit science, but the science during the lifetime of a particular Jesuit, begins with a two-page discussion under the subheading, quote, "Some Misconceptions About Jesuit Science," unquote. Without explicitly calling it a definition, Dinis refers to the, quote, "Jesuit tradition in theology, philosophy, and science during the early modern period," unquote, in his first sentence, and then determines the misconception that he perceives many researchers will have about said tradition as a, quote, unquote, "general misconceptions about the Jesuit lack of freedom in their search for truth," unquote. Yeah, the lack of freedom. Ah, okay. But what exactly is to be understood under the Jesuit tradition in science, and how can the evolved search for scientific truth can be characterized? Yeah, you see that if the author would know that truth means Jesus Christ, then it would be absolutely clear, I think. The universal or global context Ignatius of Loyola envisionized for his order, the fundamental respect for the uniqueness and individuality of persons. No, I don't read that.
Oh, boy.
Let's look up for some interesting facts here. The Orsini rose to the sun, Christoph Schreiner's Rosa Orsina Sivesol, a tract on the theory of sunspots published in 1613. Okay, no, that wasn't that what I was looking for. Oh, that looks nice. Oh, images and ideals, finally. Second commandment, absolutely unknown to Catholics and Jesuits.
And Lutherans too.
And Lutherans too, yeah. So then, let's look up what I was having here, kind of a extract. Look here. On a conceptual level, censorship had to determine which opinion and teaching were acceptable and which were not, and make them known within the society. On a practical level, it had to monitor whether the standards, which could always fall subject to change, were followed. Yeah, so that's the image last time when the teacher sat behind the pupil. Yeah, so somebody is watching you. He had to monitor. Yeah, so he had to look up. The monitor means that you will be controlled. That's a monitor in front. What you are looking at the moment at is a monitor. It's called a monitor. Sometimes it's a smartphone or laptop, but usually the television set connected to a computer has been called a monitor. Yeah. So you're monitoring the computer, but at the same time, the computer is monitoring you. of course.
What a relationship.
Yeah, that's called the secret service. You see, it's a service of the secret societies.
Oh, yeah.
The internet has not been created to serve people. It has been created to serve the authorities. Yeah, they don't need profiler anymore. They just type in what kind of websites have to be used and how long, and they know everything about you. They know when you are waking up today, then, oh, the first thing you do, put off the computer. And you said, oh, Brett has woken up 8:35. Yeah, sure. They can monitor people.
Well, and that's the thing with these phones, too. You know, you carry it with you wherever you go because you think you're going to get a call. And it has a microphone on it, you know, and a computer. And I don't know. You know, who knows what kind of data is being uploaded there, Michael?
The beginning of Jesuit teaching and the place of mathematics in the Jesuit constitutions. Jesuits, founding father Ignatius of Loyola and his companions intended for the society to become involved with education from the very start. Yeah, absolutely. Albeit their plans were far less ambitious in comparison to the extent that Jesuit schooling eventually reached. Already the Formula Instituti from 1539, drafting the principles for the future Society of Jesus, named public schooling as one of its fundamental tasks. Get them while they're young. Each Jesuit should strive forward the progress of the souls in a Christian, so-called Christian life and doctrine, and the propagation of the faith through public lectures, the ministries of the Word of God, spiritual exercises. We're talking about 1539, when the spiritual exercises were not already been written officially. Works of goodwill. Oh, works of goodwill. Oh, this is a hint. Goodwill. Goodwill. Lucy's trust. World goodwill. Lucy's trust. Welcome. What a coincidence. Goodwill is one of the most basic spiritual qualities of the human being and the great untapped resource of the heart of every human community. Ah, says who? Lucifer's publishing company. Oh, now it is Lucy's Trust. Yeah, you see, Lucy's Trust. Yeah. Okay, Lucy's Trust. Okay. And now we compare that with the Formula Institute is from 1539, when it is about spiritual exercises and works of goodwill. Mm-hmm. You see, I don't need anybody to fool me. Yeah. I don't need anybody to fool me. Yeah. So just compare the two. Just compare the two. It's just, it's the same basic spiritual qualities. Goodwill is one of the most basic spirituals. Goodwill is one of the most basic spiritual qualities. Yeah. And what do you read here? Works of goodwill, spiritual exercises. It's Jesuitical teaching. It's just to focus, contemplate on spirits and on yourself to get enlightened. Ye shall be as gods. It's every time the same in another disguise with other words.
You know, I've heard Tom Fress say that the spiritual exercises are mind control. And that's what it is. Mind control. And it's ancient. It's been around for almost 500 years.
The teaching meant here obviously refers to the Catholic Catechism, but some of the early Jesuits intermittently came to the lecture theology as established universities or teach skills such as reading and writing at a missionary station in Goa, where they eventually took on the entire organization. In the light of these first experiences, the emerging necessity to also provide instructions for the order's own progeny did not come to as a local surprise, to a total surprise. Because of its vow of poverty, yeah, and other vows too, and over a lack of funding, I highly doubt that. However, the society was and remained dependent on outside financial support. Outside financial support. Yeah, on the exoteric. Huh? This is exoteric teaching here. The first Jesuit colleagues in Gandia, Spain, and Messina, Italy, hence came into existence when the respective leaders arranged for the provision and maintenance of the necessary board and lodging in their cities in return for the Jesuits. Teaching their children and the children of their subjects. The lectures began in Ganfa in 1546, that was when Luther died almost, and yep. In Messina, yep. 2 years later. But 6 years after the papal bull, yeah, they began lectures in universities. And already at that time, they had a Formula Instituti. Yeah, they had the rules of the enterprise, drafting principles, names public schooling as one of his fundamental tests. So right from the beginning, 1539, before the Pope has given the papal bull Regimini Militantis Ecclesia, they had these principles, Formula Instituti, including public schooling. So more or less, the order of the papal bull was just an official thing. But I think it was very clear in 1539 that they had the backup of the Roman Catholic Church. In 1539. Remember, the Ratio Studiorum came 60 years later. 60 years, that's three generations. Messina is the more interesting case since it became the prototype after which many Jesuit colleagues were modeled in the 16th century. Loyola handpicked, quote, some of the best talent available to him in Rome, unquote, to set up the new institution, among them his confidant Geronimo Nadal, a trained mathematician who was voted the first rector of the Messina College by the dispatch group. In this position, he was not only tasked with setting up the instructions at his colleague, but moreover responsible for the overall success of his first Jesuit step towards organized education. Organized, Since the society had only been founded 8 years prior, the events surrounding the Messina College were taking place at a time when Ignatius of Loyola was still occupied with extending the basic principles from the formula into a full-fledged Jesuit constitution. Even with the help of Loyola's confrere and secretary Juan Alfonso de Polanco, the Constitutiones Societatis Jesu were not published until 1558, 2 years after Loyola's death. The constitutions lay out the guiding conventions and regulations for the life and work within the order by sketching the way that the Jesuits would take from the moment he applied to be a member of the society through his training up to the ministry in which he would engage, and they conclude with considerations concerning the qualities of the superior general and of the body of the society as a whole. Under the impressions of the beginning Jesuit involvement with education, the aforementioned ministries notably include the work of a teacher. Part 4 Constitutionis, devoted to Loyola's notion of the general character of Jesuit teaching, taking up 670 out of 309 pages of the entire document. Yeah, you see, we don't have to go into every nitty-gritty, yeah? But I think it's very clear they took it extremely serious. Extremely serious. The founding fathers stipulated instead that the proper teaching program was to be drafted at a later time once the society had gained enough experience. I will, with the resulting document, the so-called Ratio Atque Institutio Studiorum Societatis Jesu of 1599 later in the subsection. Although the constitutions lack details, they contain a brief listing with the designated subjects of future Jesuit instructions under the title De Scientiis Quae Tradendae Sunt in Universitatibus Societatis, on the sciences to be treated in the universities of the societies. There you got it. On the sciences to be treated in the university. It does not speak about truth. Like the entirety of the document, this chapter features a tripartite formatting, the main text, etc., etc. And this is the aim of the society and its studies, to assist our neighbors with knowing and loving God and saving their souls. And as the most appropriate way to do this is by means of theology, so this should the universities of the society apply themselves above all. So that sounds very nice on the outside.
Sounds nice, yeah. Mm-hmm. What's the end result, huh?
Mm-hmm. What's the end result? Yeah.
Yeah, so. I mean, what did we learn? It's just simple. It's the destruction of Protestantism.
Yes. Yeah, sure. That's the main goal.
Yeah. That's so when they tell you that.
When it is the goal to have a counter-reformation or an army of the Pope against the heretics or the Protestants, yeah. And the Protestants, they claim sola scriptura, so what is the opposite? Everything but scripture.
There we go. That's the strategy right there.
Yeah, Satan is the adversary, so he's the opponent. So when you claim that this is the holy word of God, and it's only the holy word and nothing else, then he says it is everything else but the holy scriptures of God. It's easy, I think.
Mm-hmm. It is.
So scholastic doctrine, Bible study, and positive theology, so where is the truth? Are named first, then the necessity of knowing Latin. Yeah, this is very necessary that you know Latin, Greek, Hebrew, and possibly Chaldaic for both theoretical and practical exercises in theology is pointed out. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Other words, make it as hard as possible to even think you can understand what's going on in Scripture.
And it is Medici learning. You see, you will be filled with useless knowledge. Yes, who needs all this languages? Yeah. So you're constantly studying and studying and studying and studying, but not studying the Word of God. Yeah, there's no time. Yeah, the theology you get from the Jesuits is from their own Bible. Uh-huh. Even the arts or natural sciences prepare the characters for theology and serve towards its perfect understanding and use and help through themselves to this end. They should be treated by learned teachers, so Jesuits, and with diligence, sincerely seeking the honor and glory of God in everything. The natural science.
Listen to that. Even the arts or natural sciences prepare the characters for theology. What characters? What are they saying here? And what is theology? It's, sheesh. No, and serve towards its perfect understanding. Oh, they paint it so vividly, mm-hmm. don't they?
Yeah, there are rhetoric talents. Yeah, we have learned that in the Jesuitical Ratio Studiorum, rhetoric is his main goal.
Exactly. But, so it's so enlightened, aren't we?
Look what mess is coming up. The natural sciences are hence included in the spheres of knowledge that are acceptable for Jesuits to know about. Mm-hmm. Nothing with truth. At the same time, however, they are restricted to being a means to an end and explicitly subordinated to theology. Yeah. There so when and theology scratch. Is changing, then science is changing too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's only then it's at the same time it's restricted to being a means to an end and subordinated to theology. So when the Roman Catholic Church changed something, then the Jesuit doctrine changes too. On the outside, it is the other way around. But you see, they don't tell you that. Yeah, logic, physics, metaphysics, and moral sciences shall be treated, and even mathematics, as much as they can help further our proposed goals. Yeah, what are your proposed goals other than to combat the Reformation?
Well, yeah, they got to take back what's been taken away from the church.
Yeah, they have to take back the knowledge.
That too. Especially the knowledge, isn't it?
At last look at chapter 12 reveals that grammar, rhetoric, as we said, poetics and history are naturally approved subject for Jesuit instruction, while the study of medicine and law is prohibited. Uh-huh. Were prohibited then. But not by accident, you see that medicine is one of the few things that you need Latin for until this very day. On the books to be read, finally offers guidance on the intellectual authorities to be followed in Jesuitical schooling. The chapter gives only two names, Thomas Aquinas for theology and Aristotle for philosophy. Yeah, there you got it, theosophy. The thing that we have concluded before. So they had mathematical programs. Yeah. But you see that it was from the beginning, it was clear that there were scholars, that they were trying to get the people when they were studying and having education. Get them while they're young. Philosophy, rhetoric, nothing to do with the truth. Nothing. Taurus developed this curriculum together. And the student and later successor, Christoph Clavius, whom Augustini Ut thus identifies at the actual beginning of the scientific tradition of the Society of Jesus. So we have to take a closer look to Christoph Clavius. Clavius gained fame as a teacher, author, compiler, and commentator. He first made a name for himself with a commentary of the Sphere of Sacro Bosco, first published in 1570, and especially a very successful commentary on Euclid's Elements, first published in 1574. The 15 books of Euclid Elements saw 5 reprints and were translated into Chinese by Matteo Ricci, so one Jesuit helping the other, one of Clavius' many students and one of the founding fathers of the Jesuit mission in China. Yeah, we know that already. Yeah. Yeah, interesting, huh? That you see that they had the means and they had the people and they were... From the beginning, it was not only a military thing like the Knights Templar, for example. Yeah? No, this was the Jesuitical thing was to so-called educate the people and the young people in the universities right from the start. Yeah, and this is Claudius Calvius being prominently named here. Therefore, I have looked up Claudius Calvius. Clavius. Ah, sorry, I have a hard time reading that name. Clavius. Yeah. Yeah, so they had very intelligent people. But intelligent does not mean morally integer or people in the truth or Christians. Yeah, no. Yeah. So I think we have to take this book as a starting point. Yeah. We have to take this book as a starting point, and then we have to conclude when we know that the Bible speaks the truth and they serve the papacy, the Jesuits. Then we know, and I have to try to study to break the Reformation into combating everybody who is in the belief of Sola Scriptura. You see that they use science as a counter for the Counter-Reformation. It's absolutely clear. Their goal was to combat Protestants. But from the beginning, also, their goal was to teach people. So that can only mean that they had the means to teach people long-term into a kind of doctrine. That is so obvious here. You see that don't want to read 200 pages here. But it is so obviously. It is so obvious. It is obvious that it is a spiritual war which is going on. And many people are losing it. Many people are actually don't believe in creation of the Bible anymore. They listen to their teachers, to their professed people, to their doctrines of devils. Doctrines of devils, that's what it is. Instruction, mathematics. Yeah. There you got it all. The Jesuit study plan begins with the declaration that, quote, one of the leading ministries of our society is teaching our neighbors in such a way that they are thereby aroused to a knowledge and love of our Maker and Redeemer. Yeah, and at the same time, nobody knows that they had certain vows and that they're about to kill and poison and slaughter everybody who's not subordinating to the Pope. Oh, what a heresy! One of your favorite words, Brett, is hypocrite. Hypocrite.
Yeah.
So 1587 published. 1586 published. Two mathematical professors at Collegium Romanum. Collegium Romanum. You see the full support of the Roman Catholic Church. 1586, 1591. Mathematics, mathematics, mathematics. And 1599, that was the final thing that they have come up with, the Ratio Studiorum. And they couldn't come up, Brett, with Ratio Studiorum if they had no teachers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's all we have to know here at the moment.
Yeah, that's really an interesting. Yeah, thank you for that photo right there. That's
every time the same. You see that there's a higher authority. So he is supreme to the pupil. This is a teacher, this is a pupil, and he's sitting behind. They're not facing each other. So he says something, but he's looking to the wall or something like this. Yeah, so he's simply indoctrinated. This is not a friendly approach if you're sitting behind somebody.
Well, notice the small book that the child has, or the young mm-hmm. adult, mm-hmm. and the much larger book that the adult has. Mm-hmm. So, in a way, they're telling you, okay, well, when you're young, you only get a small portion. But mm-hmm. when you get older, you oversee the youngsters, plus you get the large portion. You really understand when you're in the upper echelons of the society, young man. Mm-hmm. But when you're just starting out, you're not going to get very far.
Yeah.
And it's true, you know, some real truth to that image.
Martha Baldwin assesses with regard to the 17th century that Jesuitical provincials and rectors were careful to seize every opportunity to engage the favorable attention of Catholic nobles by the solicitation of patronage, for they were acutely aware that Jesuitical books of mathematics and natural philosophy. Yeah, there I lost it. I didn't copy it. But you see that now it's very clear. Yeah, they could use the nobility, because the nobility in Europe were Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And so they had the broad services of the nobility. And therefore, yeah, they had the influence because they had the nobility who served the papacy. Yeah, that's the nobility. And now it makes also sense that when we went into Prague and Rudolf II, was nobility, was the ruler. That it makes sense. It makes absolutely sense that we're pressing the Catholic nobles into this system. We're speaking about 1599, when this Jesuitical Societas Jesu, when they announced the Ratio Studiorum, and therefore all the nobility, all the noblemen, all the kings in Europe, they had a hard time because that was the military order of the papacy. Now it makes sense to me. Now it makes absolute sense to me. With the power of the Pope behind them and the funding and people also from other orders, they could force many nobility, Habsburg, etc., yeah, all the major players in Europe to that time, because they were taking over the universities. And they had the power of the Pope, because the Pope says, yes, you are my army. That is the Catholic nobility. Catholic nobility, that's the key. That's the key. And who makes the rules in the country then, there, in that time? The nobility, the king makes the rules. The king is under pressure from the papacy. The king makes some rules. The king opens or closes universities. And has a hand in selecting people, and there he falls. He's under pressure from the Roman Catholic Pope, yeah. And therefore, piece by piece, the Jesuits are taking over the education system. Yeah, that's absolutely clear to me. 1599. To me, it's absolutely clear. And from there on, we have to face the fact that these nobilities and these universities were under big pressure from the papacy, because then official document of the Jesuits had been published, the Ratio Studiorum, and they had very intelligent people around the earth, even in China at that time. Matteo Ricci. And they were so poor, these Jesuits on the outside. They said, oh, we only like to educate all your lovely pupils and your sons and daughters for our God and for the
greater glory of God.
For the greater glory, yes. Yeah. Yeah. So a sheep on the outside and a raving wolf in the inside. My. Jesuit Science Before 1773. Very interesting book. Very interesting essay. Yeah. Very interesting. Yeah. I can say that it's so nuts. This is Leonardo da Vinci, by the way. Very famous for his pentagram. Therefore, I suspect him that he is not a painter. Because these are astrological symbols here.
Oh, alchemist?
This is Mars, this is Moon, this is most likely Jupiter, this is Saturn, this is Venus, this could be, what else, Mercury or so. Oh, this is Mercury, this is Venus. I see that. As I was, you see that on the outside here, I said, oh no, he is not a painter. He is not a painter. Yeah, goodwill. Yeah, go fool yourself. a new
my new term. Go fool yourself. Yeah, but don't me. Don't fool me. Many people trying to fool us, but you see that we are more than 50 years old. We are sick of getting fooled. Mm-hmm. Leonardo da Vinci was an Italian polymath of the High Renaissance who was active as a painter. Yes, sure. Oh, he's so innocent, Brett. He was just painting a pentagram. A draftsman, an engineer, scientist, theorist, sculptor, and architect. While his fame initially rested on his achievement as a painter, he also became known for his notebooks. Oh, he worked for Apple or for Microsoft, in which he made drawings and notes on a variety of subjects, including anatomy, astronomy, botany, cartography, painting, and paleontology. Oh, yeah. Oh, and people believe everything on the internet. Huh? Oh, yeah, oh, I'm sick of Jurassic Park. Yeah. Mm-hmm. He was educated in Florence by the Italian painter and sculptor Andrea of Verrocchio, which is lesser nobility if you have a del or a of or a fun in the middle of your name. It means Andrea of the town of Verrocchio or Andrea of the family of Verrocchio. Huh? He was briefly in Rome. Oh, what did he do there in Rome? He spent his last 3 years in France, where he died 1519, so before the Jesuits. Yeah, before the Jesuits. That's why I came up with him, so that it put a little bit something in between here before we close down the session soon. And he was a technical ingenuity. He was a genius. He conceptualized flying machines, armored fighting vehicles like steel birds, huh? Concentrated solar power, an adding machine as a calculator, and a double hull, etc., etc. So he was a universal genius. Yeah? And he's coming from which town or which country would you suppose?
Italy!
Yes! If you look it up here, you will approach that he had to be some ties to the to the church as well, because nobody could study at that time, before the Reformation even, in Italy without that you being on a university of the papacy, of the Roman Catholic Church. So that is why so many of these inventors, painters, technologians, physicians, physicists, and everything else were coming out of Italy. They could hand over the knowledge in Latin to the people in Italy, because these people were used to learn in Latin at that time. And these were the only people who could read the Latin Vulgata Bible as well. In my humble opinion, that's the reason why not so many people studied this kind of stuff.
Oh, look at this, Michael. It says on the top of the page here, in the mid-1460s, Leonardo's family moved to Florence, which at the time was the center of Christian humanist thought and culture.
Yeah, it must be.
What is a humanist again? Oh, the mere humanity of Christ. Really? You want the mere humanity of Christ, so you're going to make Christ to be a pagan? Oh, okay. You can have it that way if you want. But when you do that, you completely destroy the scriptures, don't you? They have no spiritual connotation at all.
Also, you have to take into consideration that if you want to make it big time in this world, and you're coming from Italy, and you are a painter, what do you paint and for whom do you paint?
Money, 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 money.
Yeah, but you see that it is clear that it's religious things that you are doing.
Oh, sure. But I mean, you know, that's what's underneath it all is, you know, when you're a painter, you're looking for the dollars.
Yeah. Look at the name of the picture.
Oh, the Adoration of the Magi.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. Oh, yes. I remember this. This is in the intro. Mm-hmm. Images and idols, Michael.
Yeah, look at here. That's what I'm saying. He received a commission from the monks for that picture.
Wow.
Then he went into to offer his services to the Duke nobility once again with the interesting. Oh no, not this, not the Duke of Milan. Oh, all hell breaks loose. Mm. You know what that is? Mm. The arms of Francesco Forza. You don't know what that is. You drive no Italian car.
Alfa Romeo. Yes, now I know what you're speaking of. Alfa Romeo. Sure.
Yeah, the snake, which is officially spitting out the human.
What is that?
Yeah.
This is military.
This is.
Oh no! I thought that was a Templar cross.
Yeah, this is military. This is bloody military here. Yeah, this is a crown, a stylized crown, I think. This is a snake.
Human sacrifice.
Don't ask Alfa Romeo. They're coming up with some hilarious thing. I did it inside a German Bible study, and I granted much humor from Jörg and another guy. You cannot believe what kind of bullish things Alfa Romeo snake. Actually, Alfa Romeo is coming up. And I say, no, it's a snake. I think it was on Jalopnik symbol. I think that's a very strange site. I know. It's still in existence, 2014. Yeah. Alpha, give us the official line on what's up with the snake logo by Jason Tochinski. Yeah. No, prepare yourself for a big laugh.
Okay.
Yeah. Yesterday, I did some digging into the meaning behind one of the most extensive and puzzling car maker logos around, the Alfa Romeo Dragon Eating a Dude crest. I was curious about Alfa's official company line on the bench, and happily, they told me. On the left cross is a white field, is a symbol of Milan, the hometown of Alfa Romeo. On the right, a symbol of one of the most important families in the history of Milan, the Visconti family, the family that ruled Milan. There are lots of legends about the origin of this heraldic symbol, representing a mythological animal with a human in his mouth. Some believe it to be a dragon, but most likely a snake. Ah, dragon, snake. Oh, is there something in Italy?
During the time of Crusades. What? Oh, boy. Here we go.
Yeah, here we go. Yeah. Ottone Visconti, the founder of Visconti family and a knight, fought against a noble Saracen knight, nomad from a Syrian destiny that bordered the Roman Empire. Sure, Ottone beat the Saracen knight and, following the tradition, took the symbols the Saracen carried on his shield, a snake with a human in his mouth. So, why did you eat? The woman gave me the food, and therefore I eat. So he's not responsible for that symbol. It's a Saracen. It's his fault.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? You know where it's getting from. I'm not taking the blame. It's another man's fault. Yeah, so that it came just by accident, the symbol of Sarah. That I took it from a Saracen knight. Sure. And everywhere people shall believe it. And it's not.
Plausibly deniable. Mike.
It's plausibly deniable. And we do not know if it is a snake or a dragon. But you see that? I don't care. It's a both symbol for Satan.
Yep.
An animal with a human in his mouth.
Instead, the human is coming out of the snake, new man, purified and renewed. Yeah, you mean transhumanism?
Who's the one who's mixing everything around? It's a snake, huh?
Yeah.
A snake with a human in his mouth. At first glance, it looks like the snake is eating the human. Instead, the human is coming out of the snake, a new man, purified and new. Oh, he's enlightened. He shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Meaning the snake is a circular animal. A snake can assume a circular position and is an animal of the shape.
Ouroboros.
Yeah. Able to change his skin regularly and totally renew or rebirth himself.
Oh.
Yeah. So that was the story. Yeah? So not shocking. Alpha is avoiding the question whether the snake or dragon is eating a Muslim man or just some baby. These two options Simba traditionally has entirely. That's probably a smart propaganda move. Instead, they're taking advantage of the fact that the Simba isn't animated by suggesting that the man in the snake's mouth isn't going in, but rather coming out. Oh, really? And I think the majority of Alfa drivers don't care. But for me, that is a very big reason not to drive an Alfa Romeo. Mm-hmm. Although I love the car's design, you see that I don't want to support these people. I don't want to be lied openly to. I'd mentioned this possibility in the original article, and some sources corroborated this possibility in the similar world. So really, the outstretched arms of the figure in the Alfa badge remind me a bit more of a panicked, I'm being eaten by a snake, snailing, and the gestures of a person freshly reborn. But what do I know? I've never been eaten by a snake, and unless my mom is a really good liar, I've never been born from one's mouth. The bit about the snake being circular and being constantly rebound sounds a lot more like another snake symbol, the Ouroboros, than the Bischione. But I guess after a while, all these symbolic snakes start to look alike. Yeah. Besides, the symbol is ambus to decide the meaning of in the end. I mean, sure, symbols have history that you can't always ignore. That's why car companies with swastika woods ornaments are so rare. Yeah, that's why I sometimes really love the Jalopnik page. You can have some hilarious comments there. Yeah, but if Alfa Romeo wants to focus on the aging beauty of being born anew via vomiting from a colossal snake mouth, who am I to argue?
Glad that's cleared up, Michael. Wow.
Yeah.
And then there's a crown on top.
Yeah. I mentioned that, yeah. So this Visconti family, yeah.
Man.
Oh. Every time I have
Crusades there?
Every time I have a hard time reading that, because every time I just have to. It's so hilarious to see that. Yeah, this is a Visconti, yeah? And once again, what's that now? Yeah, is it a snake? Is it a dragon? Is it a snaggin? Is it a drake?
I don't think that's a new man coming out, Michael. I just don't. I don't think so.
Yeah, they rose to power in Milan during the Middle Ages, where they ruled from 200 to 470 years, initially as lords, then as dukes. So who has given them the title of lords and dukes in Italy? The effective founder of the Visconti Lordship of Milan was the Archbishop Ottone, who wrestled control of the city. Yeah? There you got it. The Archbishop Ottone. Or maybe he had a snake. I don't know. Yeah? Depiction of the Bischione swallowing a child. Oh, swallowing? Ah, that is all. Oh, this is very harsh, Wikipedia. You cannot find it.
Just it's not dude, political. It's a correct. Child. An innocent child.
Yeah.
Great. Child sacrifice.
Yeah, and that looks more like a dragon to me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's accurate.
Oh, man. An erotic child showing on an Argent and Azure serpent in the act of eating or giving birth to a human. Giving birth to a human, yes. Yeah, but what do I know, huh?
Look at the face on the guy. I don't know about that. With the
sometimes
like
you see
that,
the world is sometimes so desperate. You have to have a laugh. Yeah,
you do. Yeah,
they actually are lying. You see that also. There's a little fish in here, something like this. If you see that, you see they are constantly lying into your face. Where it is? So here it is. Yeah. Not on this. Yeah.
Okay. No problem. Yeah, constantly lying.
Yeah. They are constantly lying. These people are constantly lying. Yeah, it's so hilarious. You see that they get away with that. That's a problem. They get away with that.
It's an inside joke, Michael. That's why.
Yeah. The Bischione. A big serpent, or a dragon, or a big grass snake, or what now? Or a viper, or everything else. Let's look it up. Satan. Nope. it's like a small fishy here.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm being reborn. Is that an apple or is it fruit? I don't know. Oh, man.
He's red. He's the color of blood. So,
yeah.
I don't think it's too nice.
Yeah, you see, but all these people in Milan, all these people are interconnected. Yeah, you see that. You think that he has drawn a man into a pentagram, that he didn't know what a pentagram resembles when he's coming on in Italy. In Italy, the pentagram is also a symbol to protect you from evil. Yeah. Yeah, it's esoteric and...
I guess it depends on what you view as evil, Michael.
Yeah.
What really is evil, anyway?
Yeah, so that you see that everybody tries to get the attention and to see that, oh yeah, this is a geometry and...
Well, yeah, that's what the Theosophist always does. He turns it around and, oh, well, Christ is the evil.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's a quote of Leonardo. He said there are three classes of people, those who see when they are shown, and those who do not see. Yeah, or those who are initiated, those who are blind, and those who are the Supreme's people who are initiating the others. But you see that I'm not going to Leonardo da Vinci. You see that it's just an example that you see that you don't get famous as a painter, as a philosopher, or what else, if you're not applied to the Catholic system, especially not in Italy. You see all this, this is all Roman architecture here. Yeah? And this is all everything to do with religion here. Yeah? All to do with religion. Yeah? I just wanted to point out to him because he just had the picture with the pentagram, yeah. And so he gets away with that. He said, "Oh yeah, this is a depiction of proportions," and so something about this, it's not that interesting character except for, of course, no, the Last Supper here, Jesus Christ. That people say that, oh yeah, this is Da Vinci Code, and this is Maria, and this is not Maria, and this is his beloved and disciples is John, and oh, so many things. It is a picture of a thing which is not allowed in the Bible. Uh-huh. Nobody sees this because Italy is Roman Catholic. What is the second commandment? To depict God? I have another meaning. Do we have another opinion about it, Brett?
Oh no, it's the commandments. Even let's talk about the commandments. The second commandment was not only taken out of the Catholic Church, but a lot of the Protestant ones after Vatican.
Yeah, that's right. That's right too. Yeah.
So Michael, we are a product of this generation of Vatican Council II.
Yeah.
So how about the Council of Trent?
Yeah.
You know, some of my early discussions with Jörg Lissmann, he had mentioned that if you really want to understand Vatican Council II, you have to understand the Council of Trent, because everything points back to the Council of Trent. And the Council of Trent was the council that Martin Luther was trying so desperately hard to get involved with the church. And they would not have it, period, ever. Martin Luther never saw that day where he had a council, an open council that he was calling for. It never happened.
Mm-hmm.
So... yeah, you really have to study the history, Michael. It's much more rich than going to a church that professes to be of Martin Luther. You need to study him for yourself. That's not easy to do, but I'm just saying.
Yeah.
It's so a lot better if you do.
The last years of Leonardo da Vinci, it's with the German here. Sorry, I didn't had it didn't go into the English script, but maybe we should. Rulers of Milan, yeah. Leonardo da Vinci. Mm-hmm. Hey, where are you? Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci. It's not in the English one.
What are you looking for?
Last year's 1512.
Oh.
Okay, so it has another. Okay, so then we take the German part of the Wikipedia, or let's look it up if it's down there, là-bas, down under legacy. No? Interesting. So, Rome, in the service of the Vatican between 1512 and 1519. In the meantime, Pope Julius II hath made Rome at the center of the Italian art. When, in 1513, Giovanni de' Medici, as Pope or Antichrist Leo X, was his successor, Leonardo was from the younger brother of the Pope, Giuliano di Lorenzo de' Medici, as an artist called to Rome. Medici learning. Interesting, huh? Medici learning. Yeah, I know that you are unable to fulfill my desire, Mr. Computer, but this is a famous Medici. Yeah, this picture again. Medici family. Nobility also. Ruler of Florence. It's in entire Italy, the entire nobility is Roman Catholic. It must be. So back to topic. He was living in the Belvedere of the Vatican, and he saw many old friends like Donato Bramante or the painter Sodoma. He had an old studio with a German workmate who had the order to inform the Pope, who did not have any sympathies for Leonardo da Vinci, to inform him about his activities. Oh, that's interesting, huh? That's interesting. Uh-huh. Interesting. Oh, there's so many things. So many things. Yeah, it's so interesting. But you see that I like to close it down. It's 1:30 a.m. in the morning. I could go on and on and on. Let's close it down with the death of Mr. Leonardo da Vinci. But I have to translate it here automatically because it's so early in the morning. Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite involved, isn't it?
Yeah. So let's hand it over. On Easter Eve 1519, near death, Leonardo made his will. He determined that masses should be read and candles lit in three different churches in Amboise. He wanted to be buried in the cemetery of what was then the monarchy church of Notre Dame Saint Florentin in the Amboise castle ground, with a ceremony in which 60 poor men were to take part as torchbearers. Vasari tells of a conversion and repentance of Leonardo's on his deathbed in the castle of Clos Lucie in Amboise. Although many of his masterpieces show Christian motives, they were mostly commissioned works, no statement can be made about his attitude towards the church and religion. He was often suspected by the church of practicing magical arts. However, Leonardo was a scientist and, unlike many of his contemporaries, rejected magical practices. Now, then I asked myself that how he came up with the pentagram, but okay. Experience was the basis of his work. Yeah, you see that he could also had a wrong doctrine as some kind of protection symbol.
Research into the laws of nature interested him more than religious dogmas, but when he mentioned these, he did so with respect. After he had received the last sacraments in the church, he died on May 2, 1519. King Francis is said to have wept over the loss of Leonardo in Saint-Germain-en-Laye. Other sources report that Leonardo died in the king's arms. So legend has it, once again. Once again. Huh? He wanted to be buried in Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Speaking of Templars, wasn't that church built by the Templars?
I don't know. It's 1:30.
Yeah. All right, Michael. That is fascinating. This is a really interesting study.
Yeah, so this is also Vitruvian man, the Vitruvian man, Vitruvianischer Mensch. Homo Vitruvianus is a picture of a man from the antique architect and engineer Vitruvius with the ideal proportions. The most famous example is that writing or the painting of Leonardo da Vinci on 1419. Yeah, it's like a homo ad quadratum, homo ad circulum, okay? Ah, okay. It's about a reference to the Roman architect Vitruvius. Okay, so that's about it. But you see that, I just want to point out Leonardo da Vinci as an example. You see that it's even on the Euro coin. And on our insurance, on our health insurance credit card, and other things too, Skylab too, and so therefore he was an important figure, used or misused, we don't know, but the thing is that nobody gets famous who does not serve the papacy, and the entire nobility in not only in Italy but in entire Europe was being founded by the papacy. Yeah, that's the thing that everybody has to take into consideration. So they had all to obey the Pope. It was in Germany, it was the Holy Roman Empire of German nations. Yeah, of German nations, but the Holy Roman Empire. So it was the empire above the German nations. Yeah, there's some inventions here. Yeah, so let's skip it there and let's see what next session is coming up. Oh, there's something coming up. Interesting. Oh, I should have not forgotten this. As son of the noble Mailand family of patricians, Mr. Melzi had gained contact to Leonardo da Vinci when he was a young boy. At the 28th September 1513, he was going, accompanying him together to Rome, and therefore, from that on, he was still in the, at his side. Yeah, so he had a boy or a guy from a noble family called Melzi, who was accompanying him on a regular basis. This is interesting. Yeah. This is higher nobility in Italy, Melzi. Ah, now the computer is...
Isn't that interesting? That was about 490 some years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Man.
Yeah, and Melzi, they gained their nobility from the account of a diploma of the Emperor Friedrich III, and so they received their nobility. Yeah. And Girolamo Melzi, this guy, therefore Leonardo da Vinci lived in his villa Vabrio Dada for 3 years when he was working in Mailand. Yeah, and this is all nobility. This is the Emperor Friedrich III, Holy Roman Empire of German nations, etc., 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 etc. Oh yeah, we're making progress here. And he's got a symbol of Kaiser Friedrich III as the Grasser Castle, A-E-I-O-U.
Oh.
AEIOU. Oh, come on, Mr. Computer, I'm very tired now. Just that's this short one. Yeah. Okay, do we have it in English? We have it in English. AEIOU was a symbolic device coined by Frederick III and historically used as a motto by the Habsburgs. One note in his notebook, all the world is subject to Austria. that is actually the meaning, officially. Maybe it has some other meanings. So that means that Austria is bound to the Holy Roman Empire. You see that with the changes, its feet of the eagle, huh? Something like this, and the crescent moon, and all the things. AEIOU is the motto of the Theresian Military Academy and can be found on the wall of the Chancellor's office in the Federal Chancellery. AEIOU means all the world is subject to Austria. Interesting. Because there was once a band called Freeze. Don't know if you know that from 1984, AEIOU, I sometimes cry.
Oh, I remember.
Yeah, that was the motto of an Austrian emperor. Oh, it's nobody knows this usually. But all this nobility, it looks very sympathetic. Yeah, very nice. Nobody draws the thing to the papacy. They think that, they're independent kings and rulers and counts and duchesses and dukes. No, all are related to the papacy. All are related to the papacy. Well, 120 pages, 125 pages, 130 pages. Yeah, 150 pages. Yeah, we will make it. Come on.
Habsburgs,
yeah?
Yes.
You see, that is usual. Yeah, this is Francesco Melzi, the one who was accompanying Leonardo da Vinci, an Italian painter born into the family of Milanese. You see the city where, huh? You see with the dragon, with the snake, with the serpent, with the Ouroboros. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was one of Leonardo da Vinci's pupils. Mm-hmm. His father was an engineer and a captain of the military of Milan. Yeah, etc., 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 etc. No, I'm too tired to go into this, and also this Mr. Leonardo da Vinci is not the center of the focus of my interest. Otherwise, I would have responded quite different. But next time we will come up with the interesting things. The interesting things is not Leonardo da Vinci at the moment, but this guy. No, not this guy.
Kepler. Okay. Yes. Science. Yes. Not music at the moment, but science.
Mm-hmm. Kepler was a mathematics teacher at a seminary school in Graz, where he became an associate of Prince Hans Ulrich von Eggenberg. Later, he became an assistant to the astronomer Tycho Brahe. Where? In Prague. And that's where we go heading next time. It's about the heliocentric system. Yeah, so that's it for today. Let's close it down, Brett.
Thank you, Michael. Yeah, no, it's another very interesting set of articles in history, and
don't know where to go into this. You see that we have so many interesting texts, but I think that the hilarious thing was the Alfa Romeo explanation of the symbol. You see that if they cannot confirm things which were being set up hundreds of years ago, what do we expect? That they all are, these people all are liars in this world. They cannot say, yes, it's the old ancient symbol of the family of Milan, Visconti. No, it has another meaning. Yeah, sometimes I think it's a real gap
that people in power really think of the lay people as bold stupid. Yeah.
Well, they actually demand it, Michael. It's a demand that's placed on society. I don't know about Europe, but in the United States, it's obvious. But they want you to just go on and consume around here. They don't want you to think about anything too much. Because when you start thinking about things and you do your own research, you might find out the truth, Michael, and that's what they're afraid of. They actually double down on it. They bet that you'll never figure it out. Well, that's my personal viewpoint on it. I think they are so confident about it. They think they got the world in their back pocket, you see.
Mm.
But we hope to educate a few brave souls out there and show them that they're going to be the ones that are going to be subject to our master. No, we are not the master. Our Messiah is. And when he comes back, these people will be very, very concerned they will lose their power. And they will. But first, we have to see the rise of the beast. And that's what we're seeing in the world. The beast is coming to the forefront now. This whole beast.
That's what we are even seeing at the car models here of Alfa Romeo. You see that. How do they look? How do they look? Okay, this is a rendering, you see, that of all the things to come. But they are looking more like a snake today. This cars look very aggressive. Yeah, they all look very aggressive at the moment.
For sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't that interesting how they use the triangle pointed down? The delta symbol.
Yeah, it all looks very aggressive.
Eat ya. I'll eat ya. Coming to get you.
Yeah. But on this approach, I'd like to close it down. Thank you very much. And Brett, please close it down so that I can get in the horizontal.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Michael, for taking all the time to do the sessions with me also, because this is a learning experience and a chance for us to, you know, take a look at this all over again. And, you know, we see the serpent here, don't we? We see that the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Well, what are her delicacies? Destroying the heretics? By any means necessary, like the Jesuit oath tells us? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they celebrate it, don't they? They celebrate their triumph over the lay people with their crown on the serpent. Incredible. Yep. All the truth, it's in plain sight, Michael. All you have to do is ask some tough questions. And you might get some tough answers. But if you can handle that, well, you should definitely come back and tune in for our next session. And I think, was this the 49th one, Michael?
Yeah. Yes.
Oh, wow. So we're really at a turning point here, I think, with the script, aren't we?
Yeah, I think we have set the foundation, and from now on we are going in all the scientists in a more or less chronological order, so that you see that where Yeah, the theories and everything was evolved, were merged and together, were deleted and were coming up and were defended and were protested and were fighted about and all over again. And I think that is a very interesting thing to go into the things. And I think that from now on, everything, every new session will reveal something new. I hope. And it's so much work to go into this because I have to read so much, but I have to thank the Lord that we can put up the sessions and hope that we can do it until the last session of the series. And we are getting nearer and nearer and nearer the modern times with the modern so-called science. And oh, there is so much coming up. There's so much coming up. But we have made it into 50 sessions to the year 1600. Can you imagine? So. But we will go back and forth because we have something left out of the ancient times for specific reasons. But I think it is very interesting to know that everything is coming from the old times. And you see that the snake once again, the snake, which is on the Asclepius symbol, the staff of medicine of the so-called Greek god Asclepius, is the staff of healing. And now this is a snake who is swallowing a human. Oh, that's a small contradiction, isn't it? Isn't it? Asclepius, staff. You see, this is the staff of Asclepius, the god of healing. Or the rod of Asclepius, the god of healing. Yeah? The healing. Yeah? So he takes the snake to heal. And Alfa Romeo tells you that the snake is for rebirth? What kind of a mindset are there, huh? What kind of a mindset are there? But once again, who am I to argue? Who am I to argue? This is all doctrine of people in power.
Yeah, that's right, Michael. Good way to put it. It's the doctrine of the people in power. It's that simple, really.
Yeah.
And this is nothing new. This is hundreds of years old. They just put it right out in front of your face. Yeah, Michael, incredible. Incredible what we have to do to get by in these modern times and go along with the official narrative. It's disgusting. I'm telling you, you don't have to do it anymore. But, you know, the world won't allow you to have it. So that's our world for us, Michael. It's a very troubling, disturbing place. But, you know, the Bible says it's going to have to be, you know, because Isaiah chapter 14, you know, Lucifer's rise in the world is going to happen. It's happening. So. Problem is, I think it's happening so slow that many of us are losing patience. We have to endure. So on that note, we'll close it down and hope to see you next time. God bless and Maranatha.